I'm just going to start by reading something. It's a kind of excerpt from a kind of text. I went home for the summer, back up north for a bit, save some money and see my mates. Mum calls me to say she's put fresh sheets on my bed and that she's got a lasagna in the oven ready for my arrival. Dad picks me up from the station. I drink a bottle of wine with my parents and tell them all about my new life. I go down to the Crown around 8 o'clock and meet Eddie, Dan and TJ. They laugh at my skinny jeans. TJ excitedly says to me, "Guess who's in town?" "Who?" I reply. He tells me that the Hell's Angels are. It turns out, something coming to the screen. It turns out the Hell's Angels Motorcycle Club are holding their 50th anniversary in the castle. The next morning, I open my bedroom window and I can instantly hear the sound of lots of motorcycles in the valley. World Cup's on, so around 2 o'clock, I go down to the railway to meet my friend Tom and watch the match. A Hell's Angel is in there having a drink and watching the big screen. Later that day, I go with Tom to Dan's house to watch the next match. Dan's dad, Alan, answers the door and we have a quick catch up. We talk about university life and the history of the Hell's Angels Motorcycle Club. Later in the evening, we go to meet everyone in the fish pond. Everyone laughs at my skinny jeans again and we play pool. We then all go over to the pavilion. We dance and drink cheap drinks. I see loads of people from school. We decide after the pavilion that we should all go up to the castle. Me, Eddie, Dan, TJ and Tom all walk up together the back way. This is the same route we used to run cross country at school. The castle is all lit up and we can hear lots of people inside. As we get closer, Eddie squeals, "There's someone in the tower." Instantly, we all hit the ground, hoping that the dark figure in one of the castle's watchtowers hasn't seen us. Dan eventually whispers that there isn't a figure in the tower and it's just a shadow. We creep slowly up to the wall to try and get a better look at what's going on. We can't see anything, so we head to the main gate. It seems like quite a few of the other townsfolk want to try and get into the party. About 5 cars are parked outside and a few of the lads were talking very loudly at 3 Hell's Angels that seemed to be in charge of guarding the entrance. After a few moments, the lads went back to their cars and drove away. We decided to go up to the Hell's Angels and talk to them. They responded politely and shook our hands. They were from the Hanover chapter of the club. So that's this kind of hopefully create a bit of context for my work. This is one of the Hell's Angels that we spoke to from the Hanover chapter. I'm from a town called Matlock in Derbyshire, and this was an event that happened in my first year of university studying fine art. And I've recently been thinking about it and writing about it and making work slightly kind of connected. These are a few images of a series of screen prints. The project's called Herdy. I suppose the project is kind of based around a personal narrative around various events, including the one I just kind of read from in the town of Derbyshire, in the town of Matlock in Derbyshire. And it's kind of tries to, I suppose it aims to kind of compare the fantastical imagery, magical landscapes, illustrations of religious concepts and narratives to growing up in a small town in the Midlands or in a small town anywhere. This is kind of a clearer, kind of all printed on black screen prints. This is kind of a clearer kind of, and these are all taken from kind of medieval and Victorian kind of books, magazines and illustrations, and kind of cut them up and recolour them to make these kind of landscapes and stuff. But they're all printed on kind of black, so they don't photograph well at all. So this is just some kind of them in black and white, just so you can see what's actually going on the projector. This is a sculpture that I made. That kind of this is an older work, but kind of connects. Kind of I feel quite nicely to these collages. Similar kind of technique. Because I mainly make kind of sculptural objects. And this is a sculpture made out of black bin bags and clay. I'm just going to read another thing. Fast food chains are everywhere, from the Louvre to the Great Wall of China. You can even contemplate Egypt's Great Pyramid through the window of a Pizza Hut, which is actually located conveniently above a KFC. A perfect image of today. Which is greater, the great wonders created by humankind, or that delicious cheeseburger that tastes the same no matter where you are in the world? Why not enjoy both at the same time? In the UK, churches appear in every locality. Some of these iconic religious buildings have fallen out of use as society's priorities have changed. Some have been turned into Tesco Express supermarkets, and some even into nightclubs. In response to demographic change in the UK, some churches, nightclubs, and pubs have also been converted into mosques. More and more businesses have to be invented to avoid closure. British pubs used to open Thai restaurants inside their establishments, along with larger franchises also having to be more innovative. For example, Morrison's recently employed the Angel of the North to sell baguettes. This is kind of inspiration material, I suppose, for a work that I made. This isn't the work. This is an image of BuzzFeed that I found very recently, which is quite similar. So that's more of a recent kind of. So this is a work I made when I was studying at art school. It's a kind of it was for our interim exhibition when we were studying there. Studied with Alex. It's kind of quite interesting, kind of the mix of kind of like these kind of environments that kind of, you know, have these mixture of imagery. This is this is in the south side of Glasgow, and this is kind of derelict building that has gone through various kind of businesses, and I'm quite into this kind of signage around kind of the city, and kind of I was trying to do something for this exhibition, quite new to Glasgow, and kind of just trying to make sense of the new city I was living in, and just kind of talk about the kind of. And this is another kind of Macintosh building, the famous Willow Tea Rooms in Glasgow, which has this kind of naff kind of jewellery shop in the basement for like tourists and stuff. And it has this nice kind of similar kind of banner on top. That's how I came to that, kind of moving things around the city and kind of, recontextualizing them, I suppose. I suppose that's kind of from that point, that's kind of the direct, kind of created a kind of direction for my practice, which is mainly kind of studio based. That was an opportunity to do something quite like outside, almost like a public sculpture or something. But it kind of informed the way I work now with objects and thinking about objects and, you know, my interest in kind of tradition and consumer culture and what they kind of, the links in between. So these are some kind of studio works that are quite minimal and kind of ways that I've kind of connected kind of research objects and kind of, simply putting them together as a kind of record of my kind of work, research, and kind of using these objects. So this is a kind of chiffon scarf hung up with a digital camera hung over it, and it plays a film of a two young Tai Chi masters in Tel Aviv, practicing Tai Chi, which is a big thing in Tel Aviv, amongst the kind of young people and in the army and stuff. This is another one. Quite bright. That's a Havana flip-flop thong strap and a Incredible Hulk kind of kids boxing glove thing, kind of recast and broken up a bit. And yeah, it's kind of playing with objects and these found bits and bobs at this stage. This is a kind of bended metal, kind of making a light. This is a cast coat hanger that's been painted. So it's just playing with these everyday kind of objects and bringing things together, different objects, starting to bring, you know, kind of, simplify, kind of, actually kind of just embrace, just using objects, you know, and enjoying them and, yeah, seeing what they can do. This is another kind of example. This is kind of some more kind of video. I wouldn't say films, I'd say more like clips. I don't make films. This is my friend Kelly, who's a performance artist, a friend, and this is kind of more, this is also studio, kind of working in the studio, bringing things together, friends, you know, start to bring like family members and people I know into my work. This was kind of the beginning of that, working with Kelly. We had a studio next to each other. So this is a film of her dancing in the morning, drinking a liter kind of carton of Tropicana, dancing to Chris Isaak's Wicked Dreams, which she has a kind of funny relationship. So it's kind of like bringing, it's quite a fun, kind of playful, very studio-based kind of fun, kind of informal. So we made a series of these films together. This is another one where she is, it's her, this kind of head that we borrowed from the GSA kind of collection of kind of casts and stuff. And she's kind of making up this quite informal kind of narrative. And she's listening to the Bee Gees, How Deep Is Your Love? And she's kind of, it's a summer's day, set in the studios where we have studios. She's smoking kind of almost on a kind of romantic picnic with this beautiful piece of sculpture. So that's this kind of example of like just bringing a few things in together and kind of playing them off each other. And that's kind of how I explain my kind of working process and the kind of formal kind of side. So this is another project. This is, so kind of quite into kind of how things are kind of presented, you know, forms of display. This is a PVC vinyl banner printed quite cheaply, quite kind of similar to the idea of the banner in front of this famous architectural site. Kind of playing with that more in a studio kind of context. This is a kind of, set up kind of scene with, this is myself, my brother and a friend, an image that we used. So this is a sculpture that has, it's made up of these 3D print ceramic mini-me things made by Asda supermarket. You probably come across them. Kind of made a work using those, and there was a documentary kind of film that accompanied it that was projected on this point of sale display that was used in the supermarket. And just kind of play with that a little bit. And the 3D prints are actually of myself and Alex playing this couple, kind of taking this service a little bit further, perverse, kind of pushing this kind of, we kind of followed, it was the 3D printing guys were kind of doing a tour around all the Asda's supermarkets in the country and England, and we kind of traveled and followed them and kind of made this weird, kind of strange, creepy film about them. And they're quite creepy, kind of ghost-like objects, and got some done. I suppose it's a close-up of, like, actually in the store, kind of, I suppose, shopping for these models. In each store, they have kind of example models of the people that work there, kind of the scanner. That was one of the scanner guys on the left. That's on the right. It's a lady called Jane, who was the model for the service. So in each store, they had one of her, a little one of her, and she had the Eiffel Tower on a t-shirt, And then there's also a little Boy Scout as well. And the kind of video was a kind of creepy CCTV, semi kind of home movie thing, kind of almost kind of, yeah, kind of documentary, documenting these kind of characters that kind of reoccurred, that was displayed on the point of sale iPad TV. And this is a work, so this is another sculptural object, kind of inspired by this service, I suppose, but more kind of studio, kind of more studio thinking about it. This is entitled as an object, 3D skint. I always think of it as like a pie chart or something. And it's, so the left-hand side is some rice cakes, cast in plaster, and the second half is a pack of Asda noodles that I've cut a bit off, but it's actually a 3D print that Asda made of the noodles in the store. So it's just kind of trying to, I suppose, kind of, yeah, match these objects, bring two things together, and kind of make a kind of, yeah, kind of commentary on the process. It's almost like a pill or something as well. It's about this size, but I don't see it as like an enlarged pill of some kind. This is another kind of banner work entitled Chris, of a friend of mine that he sent me one day for no reason, and kind of hung around for a while. And it's almost like Samson slaying the Philistine, this kind of sculpture, famous kind of Renaissance sculpture of, yeah, a guy kind of attacking someone with a jawbone, you know. So that's in the there's one in the V&A that I saw recently. Pretty good. I don't know, it kind of clicked. It's kind of strange, weird, and it's kind of, I know this person. It's kind of, yeah, it's playing with that kind of relationship and trying to use, you know, use these people as kind of characters in the work. And in this show, there's sculptural objects around. He's almost kind of like looking at the work and wanting to kind of like smash it up. And yeah, it was named, the show was named after him, and it was kind of inspired by him. And he's kind of a good friend of mine. So this is a bit more kind of research for kind of another side of my practice. I suppose that's my kind of involvement in kind of contemporary consumer culture and trying to engage with it, engage with the crowd of, you know, kind of this phenomena, you know. This is a kind of link to a kind of another side of my kind of work. So it's kind of research into kind of traditional customs, you know, all over really, not just UK based, but at the moment kind of trying to focus in and kind of reading about a lot about that and kind of why we do it and, you know, the conservative kind of ideas behind that and, how these customs are practicing, you know, exceedingly more like contemporary and contextualized environment. And this is the custom of the Bury Man. I don't know if you're aware of that, which happens in South Queensferry, just outside of Edinburgh, once a year, like many other customs. The ceremony consists of the Bury Man, which is a townsman covered in head to toe in a suit of burrs. Which is quite amazing, you know, this kind of plant man. And basically he's got head to toe, a suit of burrs, and, you know, visits all the town folk and the houses, the pubs, the banks, the shops, factories. And at each location, gets a drink of whiskey. It's kind of good luck for the year. But recently, just from watching documentaries and visiting, and they continue the parade to a Tesco's. This kind of is interesting to me, how these two objects kind of collide. And like also, despite its kind of continual occurrence, the meaning of the ceremony has been like long forgotten. It's caused much speculation, interpretation in the community. So I'm interested in this kind of ideas of speculation, interpretation through the inquiry of traditional customs and their existence today. So it's quite a good image, and that connects kind of my interest in kind of supermarket culture and just an amazing image, an amazing thing, amazing artwork. This is a well dressing near where I grew up, the next town across from Matlock. Once a year, they have in the summer, they have these well dressing kind of festivals all around. It's mainly around Derbyshire. And this was one made by school kids at a local school. Usually they depict like religious scenes, kind of slightly political kind of imagery. And this was one of the Simpsons. Growing up around these, I used to think they were so boring, but now I kind of find them all fascinating, even the kind of religious ones. So I'm interested in this remix use of, you know, popular culture and these kind of traditional things. And it's quite nice when the outcomes. This is a Bart Simpson I made in the studio. No real reason, just kind of happened one day. I'm going to speed up a bit because I'm probably running out of time. Yeah. Okay, maybe I'll stop. I could just run through some things. Yeah, what has it been like for 8 minutes? Yeah. Make some ceramics. I'll wrap it up, shall I? Yeah. I won't ramble too much. This is Frodo ceramic. These are some of these Toby jugs that I make. This is a wedding where I presented them. This is another project combining kind of, a few things. So I'll just wrap it up. make kind of reliefs and stuff. Some kind of paintings, some noodles. That's it, thank you.
Just damn, simple plan. God damn, she want it. I wanna give it to her. She know that it's right here for her. I wanna see her break it down. Yeah. I'm ballin'. Throwing money around.
She a work girl, she work the pose. She break it down, she take it low. She fine as hell, she bout the dough. She doing a thing out on the floor. Her money, she make it. Look at the way she shake it. Make you want to touch it, make you want to taste it. How you lustin' for it, going crazy, facing now. Don't stop, get it. The way she shake it, make you want to hit it. Think she double jointed from the way she split it. Got your head fucked up from the way she did it. She's so much more than you used to. She know just how to move to seduce you. She gon' do the right thing and touch the right spots and dance on your lap till you ready to pop. She always ready. When you want it, she want it like an info. The info, I show you where to meet her. On the late night till daylight, the club jumping. If you want a good time, she gon' give you what you want.
Baby, it's a new age, you like my new craze. Let's get together, maybe we can start a new phase. This most have a club all hazy. Spotlights don't do you justice, baby. Why don't you come over here? You got me saying, hey, oh, I'm tired of you. Why don't you sit down on top of me? Hey, oh, I'm tired of using technology. I need you right in front of me. She won't sit. So gotta give it to her. She won't sit. She won't sit. So gotta give it to her.
Your hips, your thighs, you got me hypnotized with your hips.
So lately I work mainly within film at the moment. That isn't necessarily my complete background. I didn't really have a background in film, but that tends to be the medium I'm in at the moment. But this is a good example of my kind of starting point when I first started using film. This is mainly just holiday footage that I took from a trip kind of in my early 20s, traveling around South America. It wasn't necessarily meant to be work. And I kind of grew up with this ideology around the kind of visiting right, something that kind of Kant used to talk about in regards to our right kind of as humans existing is to be able to kind of go to these foreign places as foreigners. But kind of through working in this film, we're kind of revisiting it, all this old holiday footage, realizing there's kind of a darker side to all of this. And I started getting a lot into kind of tourist colonialism and westernization and globalization, and thinking quite a lot about the difference between kind of consecration and profanation. So this idea of what do we actually declare sacred and what are our relationships to these particular environments and how do we act? And also thinking about these ideas of experience where we're experiencing something that everybody else has kind of already experienced before you, or you've seen videos from somebody else's holiday footage. So kind of what's the authorship of that, and how do we kind of give value to these things again? And alongside that, this kind of freedom of exploitation, and I started looking at that also in regards to my own home country, kind of outside of my travels. And that's kind of the research behind this next film. So these are all clips from projects. So just kind of little bits from previous work that I've done in film.
God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with a light from white with fire.
So yeah, bit ridiculous, but these people really believe that they're having the best time of their lives. So yeah, also kind of looking at this idea of escapism versus an actual experience, and also mimicry and how much of this is actually what these people would do kind of initially, or if it's something that they've just seen, obviously with Spring Break on TV, things like that. But these were just kind of some starting points when I first started to get into film. So then jumping forward a little bit, I spent some time in Cyprus doing a residency and then an exhibition and making some film work over there. And I started to really think about this concept of mimicry as a filmmaking tool and how that kind of directs the viewer's experience with a particular environment and a place. So that piece, I shot it kind of right after the economic crisis that happened in Cyprus. So what you're seeing on the right-hand side is a structure that that was meant to be tourist resort just along the beach and then was completely abandoned. And then right down the road, about a mile down, there's one of the kind of most active beaches for locals and tourists. And at this beach, I kind of essentially stalked this man for about a week, but he acknowledged me in a way where we had this agreement that it was okay that I was filming him. But followed him around pretty much every day as he worked with these banana chairs that acted as both kind of sun chairs and also floating devices. And just as an object, I loved these chairs. But again, using this form of mimicry as almost a kind of show and tell or a tool of education in a way, but that's also very problematic. But kind of looking at that in regards to filmmaking and kind of what my position of kind of creating this mimicry and this kind of copycat of what this man's daily experience is, kind of what that does, and also by recontextualizing it into this space. And I'm also, I really love sci-fi and read quite a lot of J.G. Ballard and things like that. And there's a lot within his work where it's kind of talking about this organic world ending in order for the kind of more mineral world to begin, and that's actually a more vivid experience. So this idea that maybe the more vivid experience kind of exists within this place that's abandoned. And yeah, just really attracted to these kind of structures. I use architecture in quite a lot of my film work, actually. But today I'll just be showing you kind of, I guess, some little glimpses of that. But along this lines of using this tool of mimicry as almost a form of education, I just want to show you a clip that's a kind of a research clip.
Hiya. Once again, I'm here to present a little talk about one of the letters of the alphabet. Now today, the letter is B, and this is a B. Now, the B sort of looks like a fat man with his belt too tight, you know? And B is a very useful letter if you are fond of bread and butter, because both of these words begin with a B. And, here we go again. Okay, well now this is an R. The R looks a lot like a B with the bottom eaten off of it, in case you didn't notice. And R is used for certain words like rotten and ruin. And the letter P is a nice letter. I mean, it looks something like an R with one of the legs eaten off. And wait a minute. Hey, you. How am I supposed to talk about the letters when you keep eating pieces off them off of them, huh? Well, okay, now P is the first letter in a lot of different words, but I can't think of any at the moment. And it... well, that's an F, then. It's an F. Now, the letter F starts a number of words which I can think of, like, well, now what? Okay, that's a 1, or an I, or a small L, or a line, or dessert.
So, yeah, thinking about what's happening in this clip a little bit in regards to filmmaking and the kind of process of it, Sesame Street is quite a political kids show. I'm sure you guys are very familiar with Sesame Street. But we've got Kermit the Frog kind of playing this liberal teacher in a way. And then we've got Cookie Monster as the kind of non-conformist. But this idea that Kermit's trying to provide this kind of education of what we're looking at in order to maybe kind of give us our own voice, but at the same time kind of silencing you. In terms of what you're actually interpreting and what you're actually experiencing. And then kind of Cookie Monster being the devil's advocate in a way and not letting that happen. So yeah, that's just kind of, I guess, a little bit behind the thought process as well of how to kind of approach different methods of filmmaking and what I'm thinking about in my own work. This is an image. This is going back again. So this is an image I pulled from Facebook, actually. The one on the left is a photo I took a while ago. And it was right when I started to get into kind of photography and things like that. Beforehand, I was really kind of more drawing and sound-based. And my friend, Matt, who's actually quite a successful filmmaker, he did this where he's kind of like, oh, here's the same location I took this photo a year ago, and then you took this photo a year later, and kind of comparing the two, but kind of as a nice gesture. But I actually got really upset over it. But it was this whole idea, this is kind of going back to this, how we experience places, because this is actually back home where I grew up in California. And this hike is kind of quite remote. Not many people experience it unless you're kind of from the area. So it was this idea of, yes, you had this nice experience and kind of captured it, but I've also had that same exact experience in the same exact location a year before. So yeah, that kind of also is a little bit behind the thought process of, again, the position of the filmmaker in terms of trying to absorb and capture moments that maybe haven't been experienced before. I'll just kind of quickly go through this, but this is from another project. And it's silent. But this is when I started to think about the filmmaker as this kind of intermediary between the observational, the gestural, and the kind of experiential, and thinking about the ways that we act in regards to these very particular sculptural forms or monuments or locations. So there was quite a few of them. Of these kind of various locations. But just to give you an idea as well of some of these like site-specific objects that I'm really interested in the way that we kind of actually interact with them.
Yeah, that's it.